I serve a risen Savior, He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy, I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always near. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King. The hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart.
Hey, thanks for joining us again. It's great to have the church come together. And again, the church is not the building. The church is the people. And so I'm glad you are here. And so let's pray. Let's get into God's word and allow him to move and transform us. Father God, we praise you. We thank you for this day. We thank you, Father, for this opportunity we have to gather here in Jesus' name to worship you. And so, Father, I pray that the words of my lip and the meditation of my heart be pleasing to you, Lord God. So hide me, Father. May Jesus be seen. May he be proclaimed. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now last week, if you recall the sermon from last week, I talked about three names for God. And I shared with you in that message that God desires to provide for all your needs. And I talked the difference between needs and wants. It's in him that we find ourselves in his righteousness, as well as the peace that he desires to bring into our life in the middle of distress and turmoil. Now, I wanted to remind all of us of those truths because God's character is it ties in with the subject and our text for today. Matthew chapter 6, verse 10, we read, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." My main point being this, so if you don't get anything else today, please get this. Last week we discovered what God wants to do for you. And this week we will discover what God wants you to do for him. So what is God's will for your life? I mean, that's a powerful question, isn't it? What is God's will for your life? Several years ago, there was a man named Rick Warren who wrote a book entitled The Purpose-Driven Life. You see, the truth of the matter is, until you understand your purpose in life, you're simply drifting around like a boat on a lake. Most people call it boredom. When you do not have a purpose in your life, a person tries to find different things, thrills, excitement, many various things to bring into their life that will lead us away from boredom and misdirection. Boredom and misdirection, not having a purpose in your life, leads to depression and disillusionment. I mean, it's like we always ask ourselves the question, what am I to do? You see, every person needs to have a purpose in their life. It's kind of like, let's just say you're going to take a trip, and you come up to a crossroads, and you have to decide, okay, which way are you going to go? Now, the best way to answer that is to know, where are you going, right? Keep that in mind as we go through this message today. So what is the purpose to this life? There's a movement taking place in America and around the world. It's not a new movement. It's actually been going on for many, many years. Even though the name kind of is strange, what I'm talking about is the quote-unquote New Age movement. It's nothing new. It's been happening for years. And this New Age movement, it's kind of, it's illogical. It's irrational. And it really has no purpose to it whatsoever. You just kind of do whatever you want to do. And it amazes me that people will spend hard-earned money to go to seminars and just to try to find their purpose in life. That's the reason so many people get caught up in false cults, false teachings. I remember a cartoon I read many years ago. It showed a picture of two iguanas. They're sitting on a rock in the middle of the desert sun. And one said to the other, "I have a feeling that I lived a past life and people referred to me as Shirley MacLaine." Now, some of you may not know who Shirley MacLaine is, so Google it, you'll find out. But by the way, I wonder if Stevie Wonder, surely you know who Stevie Wonder is, but if Stevie Wonder would write a song about Shirley MacLaine, I just wonder, would part of the lyrics be, "I just called to say I was you"? I don't know. You see, for many people, life is meaningless. And they have to invent a past life to find meaning. By the way, the Bible teaches us that we die once and then comes judgment. That's a sermon for another time. You see, understanding your purpose in life produces great benefits. And one of the keys in finding happiness for your life is understanding your purpose in life. Again, one of the keys to finding happiness or fulfillment in your life is to understand your purpose in life. And one of the keys to inner peace is focusing on God's purpose for your life. So I think we could say the key to success is filling your purpose in life. Why did God put you on this planet anyway? What's God's purpose for your life? Now, along our way through this sermon today, through this sermon series, I should say, I've stated more than once that God made mankind to know Him, to have that personal, intimate relationship with Him through His Son. And along the way, I've also talked about how God made mankind to serve Him. You see, from the very beginning of creation, God created man for a job, to serve. This week, I want to take a moment and share with you two important points to help us to understand our purpose in life. You see, God made mankind to be like Him. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, we read, "Then God said, let us make man in our own image, according to our likeness. God created man in His own image. In the image of God, He created him. Male and female, He created them." God does not want us just to know Him. He wants us to be like Him. Now, in Romans chapter 8, it's a very familiar passage, beginning in verse 28. Let's read that together. "And we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to His purpose. For those whom He foreknew, He also predestined to become conformed to the image of His Son, so that He would be the firstborn among many brethren." To the church in Ephesus, Paul writes, "And that you be renewed in the spirit of your mind and put on the new self, which is in the likeness of God, has been created in righteousness and holiness of truth." Ephesians chapter 4. This was God's plan from the very start. You see, man was made different than any other part of God's creation, was he not? We're created in His image. My friends, you're different. I'm different. Let me ask you a couple of silly questions. Have you ever seen a cow pray before they eat? How about your dog? You know, you put your food, whatever it is, in a dish or whatever. Does your dog stop to give thanks before he eats? Do animals gather together on the Lord's day to worship? No, the answer is no. Of course not. See, God created mankind with the ability to communicate with Him, to fellowship with Him. God created mankind with a soul. We're unique. He wants you to become like Him, not to be a little God, but to be godly, godlike. To be like Him in love, honesty, joy, peace, patience, all the characteristics we read concerning the fruit of the Spirit. Those, my friends, are the characteristics of Christ. Jesus is our model. That is why Jesus said, when you pray, pray in this way: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. God wants us to be like His Son, Jesus, who is the Christ. To think like Him, to act like Him, to talk like Him, to work like Him, to simply be like Him, period. But I will tell you, that's a process that we call spiritual maturity. We don't instantly become like Jesus. We have to be transformed into His likeness. There's a couple of statements I want to make sure we understand. First, you cannot become like Jesus unless you know Jesus. I'm not saying just know about Him. I mean to know Him. You can't become like Jesus unless you walk with Him. How do we walk with Him? By studying His Word, by reading His teaching, by allowing the Holy Spirit to continue working in our lives to produce a Christ-like life. You see, God's number one purpose for you is for you to be more like Jesus. I just read Romans chapter 8, but I want to read it again, this time in a different translation. This is the Living Bible translation. Listen closely to how it's phrased. And we know that all that happens to us is working for our good if we love God and are fitting into His plans. Did you catch that? Love God and fitting into His plans. For from the very beginning, God decided that those who came to Him, and all along He knew who would, should become like His Son, so that His Son would be the first with many brothers. Now, please notice that Paul is saying, become like Jesus. God is working in all things so that we can become like Jesus. All that happens to us, Paul writes. Does that include difficulties? Yes. Does that include hardships? Yes. Does that include pain and suffering and sorrow? Yes, yes, yes. Even in the middle of our life struggles, God is working in us and through us to conform us or transform us into the image of Jesus. And once you understand that truth, once you understand God's goal for your life, then everything in your life will take on new meaning. You realize that God has a reason behind it. Now, before I go any farther, let me make sure we all know that I'm not saying that God causes these bad things, these difficult things to happen or to be done to us. But God allows the hardships, the difficulties to take place in our lives so that we will rely more on Him and that we will become more like Jesus. Every circumstance is an opportunity to bring honor to the Father. Every circumstance is a character builder. And once you understand that, and once you understand that He first wants to know you and to be loved by you, then the more you can become like Him in every circumstance, no matter how large, no matter how small, no matter how difficult, no matter how easy, we should be asking ourselves this question: what is God trying to teach me? How is God going to use this to help me to become more like Jesus. He will allow you to endure difficulties to build patience. He might even allow you to be offended to help you to learn forgiveness. I mean, if you've never been stabbed in the back, if nobody's ever criticized you or said something about you that was not true, how are you going to learn to practice forgiveness? And if you do not learn to practice forgiveness, then you're never going to learn to be like Jesus, because that is one of his key characteristics. God says, I want to make you to be like me. I want to work through and in all things together to give you that opportunity. You see, there's not a situation in life that you cannot learn from. So in every situation, ask yourself this simple question: what can I do to demonstrate Jesus to others and to build upon the relationship that I have with the Father? In everything, in your marriage, in your workplace, at school, in the grocery store, in the doctor's office, waiting in line at a traffic jam. And even when you feel like you're in a pit, how can I become more like him? You see, God not only wants us to become like him, he wants us to live with him someday. In writing to the church in Corinth, Paul wanted his readers then to know as well as us today. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, we read, "For we know that when this tent we live in now is taken down, when we die and leave these bodies, we will have wonderful new bodies in heaven, homes that will be ours forever, made for us by God himself and not by human hands. How weary we grow of our present bodies. That is why we look forward eagerly to the day when we shall have heavenly bodies, that we shall put on new clothes." Unfortunately, so many times we're so busy with issues of today, the here and now, that we don't even think about what's coming next, do we? I mean, there are many people that don't want to talk about death. They don't want to talk about heaven. They don't want to talk about hell. But my friends, we must. Here's an important fact. Earth is a temporary training ground. I mean, it's true. I mean, some people may have 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, even 100 years, but it's only temporary. And the more time we think about later while we're here, the better off we'll be. How you spend these years on this side of eternity is going to determine what you do in eternity. So here's a question: what have you done to prepare? I heard a story about a grandfather who was talking to his grandson one day. He asked his grandson, "What are you going to do in the next few years?" His grandson replied, "I'm going to grow up and go to high school and graduate from high school." "Oh, that's good," said Grandpa. What then?" "Well, I'm going to go to college, and after that I'm going to get a job, and I'm sure I'll get married and have a family, and if all goes well, one day I'll make a lot of money and be successful like you, Granddad, and retire." "What then?" "I guess I will eventually die." "What then?" I mean, how foolish it is we go through this life not preparing for something that everybody knows and is inevitable. How you invest your life now will determine What then? In People's Magazine, dated September 25th, 1989, was an article about a man named Tom Monahan. He was the man who came up and invented Domino's Pizza. By the way, who became very wealthy. It said in the article, in the briefcase he carries to the office each day, Tom keeps two new spiral notebooks, the kind that school kids use. He explains one is red, like the devil, for material things. The other is blue, like heaven, for spiritual things. You see, for many years, Tom spent most of his time in the red book. But Tom had a life-changing heart. And he began to rearrange his life's priorities, and now he spends most of his time in the blue. In the article, it states this, "I've always felt the most important thing for me is getting to heaven," he says. "When I die, I don't think St. Peter is going to ask me how many pizzas you sold." In John 6, we discover that God's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes on Him shall have eternal life. You see, our hope is not found in the man we put on the moon, but our hope lies in the man we hung on the cross. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. But what does that mean? And what does that mean for us today? The kingdom of God becomes real in your life when you truly come to the point and you say yes to Jesus. Now, I don't mean just saying yes. I mean truly surrendered, fully sold out to Him. You see, there's way too many people who say yes, but then when their life seems to get back in order and they get a few bucks in their pocket and things seem to go good and they think they're good enough, then they take Jesus and put Him off to the side. It was Jesus, my friends, who said, "But seek first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added to you." What an incredible promise. If you are committed to His plan for your life, then He is committed to you. Let me say that again. Please don't miss this. If you are committed to His plan for your life, then He is committed to you. And my friends, your number one job in life is to simply build up His kingdom. I'm convinced that the reason so many people struggle in life today is because they do not understand their purpose in life. If you will simply come back to the basics, getting to know God, serving Him, by the way, not for your benefit, but for His, you will have hope and understanding in your life. In a Reader's Digest magazine many years ago, there was this title that said, "Three Keys to Happiness." Well, let me share them with you. Someone to love, something to do, and something to hope for. That, my friends, is what I've been talking about the entire time. Something to love and to be loved by God. Something to do. Serve the kingdom, for there is no greater cause. And something to hope for. Heaven for all of eternity. Your kingdom come, your will be done. Let's pray. Our Father and our God, we thank You so much for this time that we have together to be able to get into Your Word. I thank You, Father, that You have challenged us this day to look for Your purpose in our life. Not for our good, but for yours. Not for our benefit, but for the building up of the kingdom of God. May your will be done. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, if you've tuned in with us very much at all, you know that at the end of every message, we always offer an invitation. It's biblical. We see it. People respond to God's call on their life. So wherever you are today, how are you going to respond to his call? How are you going to respond to his purpose for your life? It's very simple. I didn't say it's easy, but I did say it's simple. You see it simple in the fact that we understand who we are, that we're a sinner doomed to hell unless we accept God as our Lord, Jesus as our Savior, with the help of the Holy Spirit. That we confess him as such, as that we're obedient to the waters of baptism, to where we die to ourselves, we rise to walk a new life. Jesus says, being born again, that's what it's all about. Oh, by the way, I need to let you know, this invitation doesn't stop right now. This invitation continues on, but however, my friends, there will come a day when it will be too late. So may I encourage you not to wait until then. May I encourage you to respond today of God's calling on your life, confessing him, repenting, being baptized. Doesn't have to be here. It can be in the creek, it can be in a pool, it can be in a bathtub, but it's immersion, it's a burial. So if there's something we can do to help, give us a call. You can call the church, 812-591-3807, or email us, theportoffice@gmail.com. We'll be waiting to hear from you. If there's anything we can do to help, please let us know. God bless.
I'd like to read today from the book of Mark, and this is chapter 4, and we're going to pick up with verse 35 and go on through 41. And it says, on that day, when evening came, he said to them, let us go over to the other side. Leaving the crowd, they took him along with them in a boat. And just as he was and other boats were with him. And there arose a fierce gale of wind, and the waves were breaking over the boat so much that the boat was already filling up. Jesus himself was in the stern asleep on a cushion. And they woke him and said, teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? And he got up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, hush, be still. And the wind died down and it became perfectly calm. And he said to them, why are you afraid? Do you still have no faith? And they became very much afraid and said to one another, who is this that even the wind and the sea obey him? The reason I wanted to pick this text today is because there was some promises made here that Christ made to his disciples. And one of them, it says, let us go to the other side. He didn't say anything about let's go halfway, let you get drowned, let's just do away with everything. No, Christ gave them the assurance that they would make it safely to the other side. The next thing I want to point out to you is Christ was sleeping, and of course he was a very busy, busy person. And even in the rough storm, he was able to sleep. But the disciples themselves became afraid. And that's when they went and woke up Christ. And they said, do you not care that we are perishing? Well, of course he cares. He got up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, hush, be still. Now, they were professional fishermen. They have been on the sea many times. And As a sea, there's usually waves involved, but when Christ said, "Hush, be still," the wind and the waves immediately ceased to a calm, still water. And when this became perfectly calm, he said to them, "Oh, why are you still afraid? Do you still have no faith?" I believe at that moment is when the disciples understood that Jesus was God, because no one could ever talk to the waves and they would stop immediately. So that's why I believe they were afraid, is because they just realized that Christ truly is the Messiah, the Son of God. So knowing that, we have this opportune that we can commune together with Christ, that we can fellowship with him, that we can recognize that he truly is this Christ that was promised to us through the years, the one who is able to forgive all sin. And on that night, in the upper room, he took some bread and he blessed it, and he passed it among the disciples and said, "Take and eat, for this is my body given for you." And at the same time, he took a cup and he blessed it and he passed it among the disciples, saying, "This is my blood, which is shed for the forgiveness of your sin. Take and drink." Mighty God, we do thank you for this opportunity that we can share one and another with your wonderful Son, the one who made this all possible. That, Lord, mighty God, we understand that your Son is the true Messiah, the true Christ, your Son, God incarnate. And all these things we ask in your Son's name, Jesus. Amen.
As I travel through the land, singing as I go, pointing souls to Calvary, to the crimson glow. Many arrows pierce my soul from without within, but my Lord leads me on, and through him I must.
can celebrate today because we know that Jesus is alive.
Here he comes, stepping down from glory. Bethlehem was just the start of the story. Here he comes. Oh, here he comes. Here he comes, teaching in the temple, making timeless wisdom sound simple. Here he comes. Oh, here he comes. Here he comes to seek and save, wash our every sin away. Hear the captain start to say, here he comes. Here he comes, giving sight to the blind man, calling out, giving life to the dead man. Here he comes.
Here he comes.
Oh, here he comes.
Here he comes.
Here he comes, Hosanna's loudly ringing, carries the cross along the way of suffering. Here he comes.
Here he comes.
Oh, here he comes.
Here he comes.
Here he comes to seek and save, wash our every sin away. Hear the captain start to say, here he comes.
Here he comes, a miracle of sunrise. An empty tomb is shouting, he's alive.
Here he comes.
Here he comes.
Oh, here he comes. Here he comes, oh, glorious day. He is risen from the grave. All creation shouts his praise. Here he comes.
My heart beats with expectation. My soul aches with anticipation. Oh, what a moment of celebration when I see him in the sky.
Story.
Here he comes.
Here he comes.
Oh,
here he comes.
Here he comes. And I can't wait for the dawning of the day when the angel finally say, here he comes.
Here he comes.
Here he
comes. Here he comes. Here he comes.
Here he comes.
Here he comes.
On behalf of myself and the leadership here at the Westport Christian Church, we want to thank you for tuning us in, to watching us online, and please share us with others. And like I said earlier, if there's anything we can do, we'll do our very best. Give us a call, give us an opportunity to serve you. And until we can meet again, remember, be safe, and Jesus loves you, and so do I. Until then, take care. God bless.